Thank you very much for the introduction. It's great to be here. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about kind of the research that's been going on in my group, an overarching aspect of all the different projects. We'll have some focus. I know there's a lot of interest on IRIS. We'll talk a little bit about that, but then we'll also talk about the various other projects as well. I should also acknowledge, you know, the various different collaborators, including the students and other faculty that I've worked on this research. Okay, so let's see, let's get started. So within my research group, one of the key focuses that we look at is addressing the processing of video, because we believe video is the biggest of the big data, right? So if you think of, you know, the communication channels, over 70% of today's internet traffic is to represent or transmit video or pixels in general. And then if you think about the amount of video content that's being generated these days, over 300 hours of video is uploaded to YouTube every minute. And this is actually an old statistic, so you can imagine it's even higher now, or if you look on Facebook, it's also very video-driven. And over 500 million hours of video surveillance is collected every day. So we know that video is very important just in terms of the amount of data that's being generated and the cost to communicate it. A lot of this video, the growth of this video has happened because a lot of the video is captured on these kind of battery-operated devices, right? So these days on your phone, you must have some kind of camera on it. Although ideally you'd like to do a lot of the processing of the video on these kind of edge devices, the energy is quite limited. And so you have to send it to the cloud. And often it's kind of undesirable to do this because you want to process it locally either for privacy reasons, you don't want to share all your video to the cloud, for latency reasons. So you see here with the drone, if you want to navigate, you can't afford to send it to the cloud and wait for the analysis of the video to come back. Or even sometimes you have very limited communications. But nonetheless, because of the energy limitation these days, what happens is that we compress the video and we send it to the cloud. And a lot of this data is going to be processed and analyzed in the cloud. But even if you think about where the processing of the cloud happens, it often happens in a data center. The amount of compute that you can put into a data center really depends on the power consumption, because the power is basically limited by the heat dissipation. Right? These days you have to even try and build these data centers near a power generation plant. So as a result, regardless of where you actually process the pixels, you know, you need energy efficient pixel processing. In our particular work, we're going to try and focus on how we can do a lot of the processing on the edge device, but you can imagine some of these things that we're talking about also apply to the cloud itself. So there's two kind of primary forms of pixel processing that are very critical in the space. So the first is compression. So in general, if you're going to have to store or transmit pixels, you're going to have to compress it. So we have various efforts in our group looking at increasing coding efficiency, but in addition to that, so increasing coding efficiency means you compress better. So for the same quality of video, you have fewer bits. But you also care about speed, right? So speed is also an important aspect because we're looking at higher and higher resolutions these days, and you have to be able to process, you know, at ultra HD or 8K, you know, 16, which is 16 times more pixels than regular HD. And of course, energy efficiency is also critical. So we have some effort in that, but most of the research today I'm going to talk about is more, rather than just compressing the pixels, can we actually understand the pixels themselves? There's a lot of applications where you might not necessarily want to watch the video again. You just want to kind of extract the meaningful information out of the video. And you can even think of that as kind of the ultimate form of compression, right? Just extracting what's the minimum data that I need. And you can see applications of that could be, for example, in self-driving cars. Nobody actually wants to watch the video feed that the self-driving car collects. You just want to get the information and tell you where to go. And so kind of an overarching goal in our group is that we try to ask, can we make, you know, understanding the pixels, particularly computer vision, as energy efficient as compression? Because we know that compression is basically there on any image sensor that you have out there. So for the same cost in terms of energy, in terms of area, can we actually just understand the pixels, right, and just more directly address this? Okay, so that's kind of the focus. In terms of how we approach these type of problems within our group, we actually do a very kind of cross-cutting approach. So we start off with like algorithms and applications, kind of understanding, you know, in this particular application, what's the best type of algorithm to do to, you know, get us a certain quality of result. And then we push down to looking at architectures in terms of how can we build hardware to really support these algorithms. And architectural decisions we might try to make are in terms of, oh, you know, where should we put the memory, how much memory should go where. And then to demonstrate it, we actually have to build circuits. So we actually, depending on what particular project it is, we might actually fabricate some custom hardware. And then finally, what's really important in our group is actually integrated this chip or the circuit into an actual system. So we want to demonstrate kind of end-to-end results, not just bits in, bits out for the chip, but really, you know, taking pixels in and taking an action, right? And so you'll see a lot of kind of system-level types of demos in this work. Okay, so I'll start at the very beginning of where I kind of my own research career landed, which is looking at video coding or video compression. And you may be familiar with the standard HEVC, or it's also known as H.265, and it's a successor to H.264, which is actually, you know, widely used to compress video on the internet. This standard was developed around, you know, 2010 to 2013, and really the goal here for this particular standard was to achieve twice the compression of H.264. So what does that mean? For the same quality of video, you take half the number of bits to store it or send it. But the interesting thing for this particular standard is that we also tried to factor in some implementation challenges in the design of the standard. So looking at, you know, higher throughput, so the target for this standard is reaching Ultra HD 8K at 120 frames per second, so it should be able to meet that, and then also have lower power consumption. So this is kind of one of the first examples of doing joint algorithm and hardware design. We don't just do the algorithm and kind of throw it over. We actually consider what are the hardware implications of designing these algorithms. So in general, these standards happen about every 10 years. So you might also be familiar with MPEG-2, which is kind of what's being used to send HDTV over the air. And so every 10 years or so, we have a new standard, and we basically reduce the amount of storage required by half. So that's when we say 2x higher compression, that's what it means, that the size is reduced by half. But what's interesting about the standard is that because we really factored in, you know, the implementation costs, even though when we jumped from MPEG-2 to 264, we had to increase the energy by 4x, going from H.264 to HEVC only required a 1.5x increase in the energy. And what's kind of impressive about this, if you just take a step back, is that you would imagine it's going to get harder, more and more difficult to compress as time goes on. But even despite the fact that you have to do, you know, it's a much more difficult task to get 2x compression going from 264 to 265, you actually require less energy than going from MPEG 2 to H.264. So I just want to show it's really important kind of thinking about this co-design of algorithms and hardware can really have an impact. The other thing I just want to emphasize is, you know, 265 or HEVC is widely already used in a wide range of applications today. And then recently, last year, they also won a primetime Emmy. So you can win an Emmy as an engineer. So, you know, this is one example of commercial success of doing joint design of algorithms and hardware. And so the question for us is, can we take this into these other applications of, again, understanding the pixels and these kind of next generation video processing applications? So the first thing I want to establish, though, is that why is vision difficult, right? So if we could do this for video, why can't we just directly do this for, you know, computer vision? So if I give you an image like this, you guys can hopefully, even if it's early, tell me what's in this image, right? Cat, right? So A+ for everybody. But if you were to actually computer and looked at it, what you would actually see is just a bunch of numbers. And that becomes a much more difficult task to do. So imagine if you were given just these numbers and asked to tell me what the object is, right? And so with these numbers, you can easily compress. You can still apply compression algorithms. But understanding is going to be very challenging. So right off the bat, I just really want to emphasize that video computer vision requires much more processing than video compression, just because it's a much more difficult task. You typically have to project it into a higher dimensional space in order to analyze the image. But despite this, we were able to, like, kind of the very first question we had in my group was to understand, can we make, you know, understanding the pixels as energy efficient as video compression? So we did have some work looking at the task of object detection, where I give you an actual image, and I want you to not only tell me what's in the image, but where it actually is. So for example, here we're detecting pedestrians and cars, and you can see that, you know, these pedestrians can be detected at different distances. And then through this work, which was published at VLSI, we really looked at the co-design of this object detection algorithm and the hardware itself to see if we can do this object detection task at very low energy, kind of what's the limit that we can push this energy consumption down in. And so shown here below is basically the energy per pixel that we consumed. This is, so the work that, you know, we presented at VLSI doing object detection was shown here in the red. And so you can see that it's consuming about, you know, 0.4 to almost 1 nanojoule per pixel, depending on the type of object detection that we do. And when you compare it to kind of previous ways in which people do video compression, so both decoder and encoder for various standards, we're at the same order of magnitude. So despite the fact that it is a very challenging task to understand the content of the video, it is possible to do kind of a joint design of algorithm and hardware such that you can for the same amount of energy that you would spend compressing the video, you can actually now understand certain contents of the video. One particular question that still kind of lies out there is, you know, how accurate is this understanding of the video itself? It's one thing to just look at energy, but it's always really important when you look at, you know, changing the algorithm and the hardware to look at the accuracy or the quality of the algorithm as well. So when we take a step back and we look at the accuracies, this previous work from VLSI is primarily looking at hog and deformable parts models, which are approaches that were used around 2010, 2011. And so you all may be familiar with, you know, the recent advances in deep learning. So starting 2012, there was some work from Jeffrey Hinton's group by Alex Koresky looking at using deep learning, particularly deep convolutional neural networks, and applying it to computer vision tasks. And compared to previous approaches, there was a significant drop in terms of error. Right? So this plot in particular shows results from this ImageNet challenge where I give you an image and you have to classify into one of 1,000 different classes. Right? And if, you know, your top class, you know, your top five classes, if one of the top five classes that you've classified it in is correct, it's considered fine. So here, you know, this is the error, so the lower the better. So you can see a substantial drop from 2011 to 2012 due to the use of deep learning. And then since then, there's been a continual reduction in terms of the error. And why people are very excited about this field is because of this improvement in accuracy or drop in error. And in fact, in 2015, using ResNet from Microsoft, they were able to beat a human level accuracy in terms of doing this task. Of course, it's always important to point out that this human is, you know, one student at Stanford representing all of mankind. But nonetheless, you know, it's a good reference point to have. So while this is very impressive, and this is why people are very excited about deep learning, again, this comes as a trade-off in terms of it requires significantly more computation than the previous approaches. So I'll spend kind of the next couple minutes talking about how deep learning works, so we understand, you know, what's there, what are the challenges, and then how we try to address it in terms of both the hardware and then also the algorithm point of view. Okay, so again, also deep learning, we've already seen a wide use, many use cases of it in, you know, industry, from computer vision to speech recognition. You might have been familiar with this AlphaGo work in terms of gameplay and having deep learning really beat the world champion at the game of Go, which is kind of one of the grand AI challenges. And then also in the medical space, it's really taking off. So what exactly is deep learning? So how is it different from the previous approaches that we've seen? So let's start with a simple example of image classification where you just get one particular image and then the output should just tell you, you know, what is the class of the object in the image itself. It doesn't tell you where, but what, you know, what's in the image. So you can imagine an image goes through what we would call, this would be what we call a neural network. And this neural network has multiple layers. And each of these layers basically consists of some filters, okay? So at the end of the day, it's just a bunch of filters, and each of these filters will extract, you know, apply the filter to, you know, your input image, and you get some features. In particular, what will happen in a neural net is that the, you know, the earlier layers will extract these low-level features, which are typically like edges in an image, and then as you get further, deeper and deeper into the network, you get higher-level features. For example, for the car, you get wheels or different, at the end, different orientations of the car. So what are the impressive parts about deep learning? One is that it becomes very deep, so you can build this hierarchy of features. And the other thing is what really uniquely distinguishes it from previous approaches is that the filters that are used to, you know, basically teach you how to extract these features are all learned from the data. So in the past, you might have a computer vision expert come in and say, hey, I think, you know, edges are really important. Let's design a custom feature to extract these edges. And that's very much how that hog work stuff worked from before. But now all of these, you know, features and filters that extract these features can be learned directly from the data. And that's really what they mean by a data-driven approach. Okay, so let's talk more deeply about deep convolutional neural nets. So again, I just really want to emphasize the idea of these neural nets that we stack multiple convolutional layers across each other. And then so you have from lower level features to higher level features. I really want to emphasize the concept of CNNs has been around for like decades, right? So Jan LeCun looked at them in the 80s and the 90s. But what's really kind of differentiated them now compared to the past is that you have more data, so you can make it the network much deeper. So in fact, there are publications these days that go up to 1,000 convolutional layers. And you can imagine this generates higher and higher level features, and that's why it becomes very powerful. And then often after these convolutional layers, you have a bunch of fully connected layers. And this is for, again, an image classification task where you would output, you know, the different classes that the object might depend on or might belong to. So the real thing I really want to focus on is the convolutions, because actually the convolutions account for more than 90% of the overall computation. So they really dominate the runtime and the energy consumption. So if you're going to build specialized hardware, this is where you should really focus, right? You shouldn't focus your time on the other 10%, but really looking at how we can minimize the cost of convolutions. So I'm going to basically walk through the convolutions. And so some of you guys have probably taken, you know, signals and systems class in undergrad. So you said, I've seen convolutions before, what's the big deal? Or you might have taken an image processing class and say, okay, 2D convolutions, no big deal. So I'm going to try and illustrate to you why it's a challenge, particularly for CNNs. So let's start with a very basic example. So let's say I have an input image or a feature map if I'm deeper into the network, and I'm going to apply a 2D filter. Right? So what does that involve? We do an element-wise multiplication with this image. We add the results from the element-wise multiplication together, and we get one output pixel. And then because it's convolution, we just slide the filter across, and we generate more pixels. So this is kind of image processing 101, nothing special here. So why is it challenging for neural nets? So the next thing is that we actually increase the dimensionality. Right? So they have this third dimension called the channels. So now, as opposed to just doing a 2D convolution, you have to do a 2D convolution on each of the channels and then add the results together just to generate one value. You can think of a channel, for example, as in the input image, your channels might be the red, green, and blue components. That's a logical thing. But what happens is as you go deeper into the network, the number of channels increases. So if we take AlexNet, which was that, you know, winning neural network architecture from 2012, the number of channels can go between 3 to 192, depending on which layer it is. So you can already see how it's kind of growing a lot in the second dimension, or the third dimension. Another challenge is that you're not applying one filter, but you're going to apply multiple filters to the same image. Okay? And so the number of filters that you have, so each of these filters will generate actually one output channel. Right? So we have one filter here that generates one output channel of the output. You have M filters will generate M output channels. Okay, that's kind of how channels and filters are related. Each of these filters will generate one output. And the number of filters that you have in AlexNet are also very large, so 96 to 384 as an example. So you can already see how the dimensionality really grows. And then just to, you know, kind of complete the picture, in general, we typically like to process more than one image at a time. And so it depends on how many images you can actually fit onto your hardware. But in general, we refer to this as a batch of images. So if we're processing multiple images, typically between 1 to 256, then we'll generate multiple outputs. Right? And we refer to this as the batch size. Okay, so hopefully you can see why it's more complicated now compared to regular image processing. Another additional challenge that we have when we talk about, you know, doing convolutional neural nets is that, number one, the filter sizes are very large in size. So if we look at layer 1, layer 2, layer 3, we're talking about tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands of weight parameters in the filter to do the processing. And this is not the video itself. These are the weights of the filter, right? This is not even including the typical data that you have to manipulate. These are just the filter weights. And then if you look at the amount of processing, we're talking about hundreds of millions of multiplies and accumulates. So that's the first challenge. It's large in size. The second challenge is that it varies. The shapes of the filters will also vary, right? So you can't have some hard-coded hardware. You really have to have some flexibility. So for example, if we look at the different layers of AlexNet, we can see that the filter sizes will change, the number of filters will change, and also the number of channels will change. And so your hardware has to be flexible enough to support all these different dimensionalities. Now, there has been some, well, now no longer recent, but some work looking at networks that really have a fixed filter size to really avoid the variation here. So you may be familiar with VGG that does that. However, the number of filters and the number of channels, even for that type of work, will still continue to change. So you need to have some flexibility and programmability in your hardware. Okay, but you know, all is not lost. There are some properties that are beneficial from a neural network standpoint that can really help us. So the first thing is that, you know, at the end of the day, it's just a bunch of multiplies and accumulates. And so high parallelism is actually possible, and then you can use that to translate to higher throughput. So that's not an issue. I can do all these multiplies and accumulates at the same time. The actual big challenge is how do I get the data, the memory access, to the actual multiply and accumulate engine, right? So there's two ways of looking at this. So first thing is every single time you do a MAC, a multiply and accumulate, we actually need three inputs. So you have a filter weight, an image pixel, and a partial sum. And then you generate one output, an updated partial sum. So that's a 4-to-1 ratio in terms of memory access versus compute. The second challenge here, of course, is that the cost to energy cost of accessing data often is much higher than the compute itself. So in the very worst case, and you would never do this, but just to give you an idea of how bad it could be, is that if you actually accessed all your data from an off-chip DRAM, it would cost each access is 200 times more energy than doing the computation itself. So these are two, that's two orders of magnitude difference in terms of the energy cost. And this is per access. And again, we're talking about four access per operation. So it's significantly challenging. And of course, if you look at AlexNet's example, to do 700 million multiplies and accumulates, you need 3 billion DRAM accesses. Right? So this is a significant problem. But again, this is not lost. There are some ways that we can approach this to make this more feasible. So one is the idea of basically trying to figure out ways to reuse data. Right? So, and so can we basically move data, rather than storing in the DRAM, move it into a low-cost memory and then use it multiple times? And I'll give you some examples of possible data reuse that's in the convolutional neural net. So the very first one shown here on the left-hand side is convolutional reuse. So if you think about when you're doing this 2D convolution, you're actually reusing the same the same data, the pixels and weights, over and over again, just in different combinations. Right? So you can imagine storing those pieces on chip and then just reusing them over and over again. So you don't have to move them that often. Another opportunity is what we call image reuse, which is that I'm going to apply multiple filters to the same image. So in theory, I can just keep that image pixel or those pixels on chip and then apply the filters multiple times to them. So I don't have to move or reread that image pixel multiple times. And then finally, if I'm going to do multiple images, we actually have this form called filter reuse. So I just use one filter and I apply it on multiple images. So there's an also opportunity there where I just read the filter once and I use it multiple times. Okay, so these are the different techniques that we can exploit, and they come naturally within the CNN. So taking a step back, so what is the actual architecture that we would want to use to support this processing? So there's actually kind of two very popular approaches for parallel processing. One is what we would call a temporal architecture, and you might be familiar with this in the sense that it's basically SIMD or SIMT, which is basically the CPU or GPU version. And the idea is this. So I have a bunch of parallel engines all operating together. They all share the same control, so all doing the same thing, and they all share this large register file. Okay, so they're doing all the processing in parallel. An alternative architecture is the spatial architecture, and the idea is that I want to basically distribute the register, the memory, and the control to each of these units, and I want them to be able to talk to each other. In terms of the size of the memory that I want for each of these small memories I want to put at each of these ALUs or processing elements, we're talking about 0.5 to 1 KByte of memory, very, very small. And the reason for this, which I'll mention later, is because smaller memories are very cheap to read and write from. And they all have their own control, so they can all operate autonomously. And then also, we allow for communication between the ALUs, so you can share data with your neighbors, which is often going to be cheaper than going off-chip. So this is the architecture that we've adopted for the IrisWorks. So I'll focus more on how we can utilize this architecture. And the real challenge is, I don't have the slide here, but the real challenge is, how do you take this very large neural network and then map it to this architecture? Again, I just really want to emphasize that data movement is expensive. So again, kind of walking through as an example, if a multiply and accumulate is 1x, reading from that small register file, which is 1k byte or less, is also 1x. Reading from the neighbor is twice the energy. Reading from a global buffer, which is typically 100k bytes or 500k bytes, is six times as much energy. And of course, going to DRAM is the worst. And so really, you want to do most of your reads and writes down here at the lower levels of the memory hierarchy. The challenge, of course, is down here, the amount of storage you have is quite limited, right? So our register file is only basically 1k byte of memory. So how can you fit this very large neural network that we talked about, hundreds of thousands or millions of parameters? How can we fit it in such a small memory? And that's really the challenge. So basically, that's basically where we dictate this, what we call a data flow. So how do we take this large convolutional system, map it onto the spatial architecture so that we can increase the reuse of the input data, so the weights and pixels, when I read it once, can I use it multiple times? But also what's really important is also to do as much partial sum local accumulations as possible. Partial sums, which is often ignored but is very important, is actually when you multiply the pixels and the weights, you have this intermediate value called partial sums, and these need to be added together, right? And what it turns out to be is that if you maximize the reuse of the pixels or the weights, the partial sums will spread all over the place, and it's going to be very difficult to do local accumulation for that. And we'll show you a couple examples. So as you might imagine with, you know, deep learning, it's a very popular area of research today. So there's a huge amount of research going on in this space. And so for our group, the first thing we wanted to do was kind of classify the different ways with which people took a CNN and mapped it onto a spatial architecture. And so we found that there were basically three main classes in terms of how people did it. So the first is what we call weight stationary. And the idea here is that basically I want to store this weight, the weights themselves, in the register file within the PE, so the weights don't move. The weights are always going to be read from that really cheap register file, so you're minimizing the read energy of the weights. Right? So the weight's stationary, weight's cheap, but what is the cost of that? Well, then the partial sums and the pixels now have to move through the network. Right? So they have to go through the NOC, they have to go through the global buffer, they're going to burn more power. And these are various examples of works that use this type of data flow. Another approach is what we call output stationary. And the idea here is that you say, okay, I don't care about weights, I actually care about the partial sums because I have to do both reads and writes for partial sums. And I want to do all the reads and writes from the local register file. So now the output, so each PE is going to compute as much as possible the full output. So the output is now stationary within each PE. And instead, the pixels and weights now have to move through the network and the global buffer. Finally, there's another class that basically says, well, okay, so the issue is I know DRAM is very expensive. And if I can store more data on chip, the better. But I also know these very small memories are very inefficient. When you have these very small memories, you know, the area to bit ratio is very poor because you can't amortize the peripheral cost, right? So this work, the no local reuse work, their approach is forget all these little memories. Let's save all that area and make one really large global buffer. So overall, for the same area, I can store more bits on my chip, right? And as a result, I can reduce DRAM access. But the cost of that is that you're going to have traffic, you know, everywhere for all your other data types. So you're going to have more on-chip traffic, but you're going to have less off-chip traffic. And then finally, I mean, in the interest of time, I can't go through too much of the details, but within our group, we developed what we called the row stationary data flow. And really what we tried to do is not focus on a particular data type itself, but really try to balance the data movement of both the weights, the rows, and the partial sums. And really, at a very high level, the thing I would say is what we do is within each PE, we do a 1D convolution of the weights and the filters so that most of the access is from that register file and all the accumulation to do that 1D convolution is all local. Within the array itself, we try and share a lot of the data. So we have a lot of communication with in terms of partial sums. They're vertically accumulated. The benefit of that is that we don't have to go to that expensive global buffer. And then similarly, you can see there's a lot of redundancy in the read. So the going horizontally in terms of the filter rows, the rows are the same. So I can read once and then reuse the filter weights horizontally, or I can read once in terms of the data itself and then reuse diagonally. Okay, so it really tries to balance all these different data types. And so when I try to compare, you know, all these different data flows that were done, that were used. So this is the weight stationary, this is output stationary, no local reuse, and row stationary. This is the energy, you know, estimated per MAC, includes the data movement itself. And this is for the same number of PEs, 256. This is all for AlexNet with the same area restriction. You can see that the row stationary is more energy efficient than the other approaches. Just to kind of make sense of what's going on in this graph, if you look at the weight stationary, for example, by design, the weight energy shown here in the green is the smallest. That was the goal of that work. But you can see it comes at a cost of increasing the partial sum energy and the pixel energy. If you look at the output stationary, there's three different variations of that depending on the type of layer. You can see that the partial sum, the red part of this, is really reduced because that's by design. We didn't want the partial sums to, all the partial sums basically come from this low-cost memory. But we can see that the pixels themselves also consume a lot of energy and the weights itself. In terms of no local reuse, we don't have the slide here, but if you look at the paper with respect to this, what ends up happening is that the DRAM energy is very small. That's by design. But because of all the traffic that's on the chip, all the other energies kind of increase. And so row stationary, really the main message we want to get across here is the row stationary really tries to balance the energy consumption of you know, weights, partial sums, and pixels as well. And it also tries to balance the energy consumption of both your DRAM and your on-chip access. So if I could, you know, give any high-level message here, when you're doing these types of designs, you really want to take into consideration, you know, all the different data types, all the different types of movements that you have on your chip, and you also want to look at both chip energy as well as DRAM energy, so basically system-wide energy. You don't want to always just optimize for one kind of metric alone. The other thing that we looked at in terms of our iris work, in terms of, you know, can we further improve it, is that we noticed at the time that, you know, we have an input, you know, shown here, and then there, each of these, I didn't really talk about this, but in deep learning, they have this nonlinearity that you apply at the, you know, end of each layer. And basically what this nonlinearity allows you to do is it allows you to represent a higher set of functions, but also basically using this ReLU, this nonlinearity, this rectified linear unit, you're basically setting all the negative values to zero. That's what it basically, it's a very simple nonlinearity. And so zeros, well, there's a lot of things that we can do with zeros in terms of making our system more efficient. Just to give you a sense of, in terms of how many zeros there are, first of all, if we look at the different convolutional layers, again, this is for AlexNet, you can see here, you know, on the first layer, maybe about 60% of the values are non-zero, meaning there's 40% of zeros. And then as you get deeper into the network, you're primarily dominated by zeros. So what can we do to exploit the fact that we have a lot of zeros in our data? So the first thing that we can do is, obviously, you can skip the operation. So any multiplication with a zero is going to be a zero, so you shouldn't perform that multiplication. And you should also avoid doing the reads for the weights themselves. If my activation is zero, I can just avoid reading the weight information. And this actually gives you about a 45% reduction in power consumption. The other thing that we want to do is we want to reduce data movement because it's very expensive. So with zeros, what can you do? Well, you can do some compression, right? You don't have to send all those zeros. You can use, for example, run length coding. And this enables you to actually reduce the amount of DRAM access for different layers. You can go all the way down to about 2x for AlexNet. And this is just looking at the basically the activation data. I should mention now, since this work, people have also explored looking at, you know, making the weight sparse as well. And you can use similar techniques to it. You basically get benefits from the sparsity and the weights. So to demonstrate all this, we actually built a chip to demonstrate the row stationary data flow. So this is the Iris chip. Basically, it has, you know, 14 by 12, so 168 processing elements. It has each of these processing elements have about 1 kbyte of local memory. We have a global buffer that's about 100 kbytes. And, you know, we have this off-chip communication. You can see there's compression decompression here to help, you know, balance the compression that we just talked about, to exploit the sparsity and the activations. And we also fabricated a chip. When you compare it to, what we compared it to at the time was the NVIDIA TK1 chip, which is their mobile processor. You had over a 10x improvement in energy consumption, despite the fact that, you know, this chip is in 65 nanometer CMOS and their chip was in 28 nanometers. Again, one thing I just really want to emphasize is that it's important for our group to actually build systems. So we actually integrated the Iris system into a real-time demo. This is based on the Berkeley's CAFE deep learning framework, and it's running AlexNet. It's doing a 1,000 class image classification task. So you can take an image, let's say, of a dog. Okay, and then you can send it to the chip itself. So shown here is the actual chip right here, and then here's the power consumption. It flips pretty quickly. And then you can see that when it goes back, it properly classifies that, you know, it's a dog, and then it also tells you what kind of dog it actually is. So, you know, the fact that it can do this classification has to do with the fact that it's AlexNet, not necessarily our chip. But what we want to show is that our chip is configurable enough to support all the different layers of AlexNet to complete this task. And I think that's important to show. So you always want to make sure your, you know, chip does what you promise it will do, and that we've, you know, factored in all the external components into the account. Okay, so if we take a step back, you know, we talked very briefly about object detection, and then we talked about deep learning hardware and efficiency. So if I, you know, just care about, you know, object detection, what I really actually care about is just the trade-off between energy consumption and accuracy. So this is for an object detection task. These different points are, this is basically the object detection chip that was based on Hog, and then this is the Iris chip running two different neural networks. You can see the accuracy is in a linear scale, and the energy is an exponential scale. And so what are we, and so just as a reference, video compression is just around 1 nanojoule per pixel. So what are we noticing here? To basically get about a, you know, maybe a 2x increase in accuracy from Hog to AlexNet, you need a 300 increase in terms of energy. And to get, you know, a little bit higher increase in accuracy, you need over, you know, 10,000x increase in energy. So you should really ask yourselves, you know, think about, you know, running your cell phone. Would you be willing for double the accuracy to have your battery run out 300 times faster or 10,000 times faster? Right. So these trade-offs, though, you know, from an algorithm point of view, if you look at talk to computer vision people, they really want to push on this line. you should always also think about in the use case, what is the cost on the energy scale as well. So clearly there's still a lot to be done to try and, even with custom hardware, to reduce the energy cost of, let's say, AlexNet and VGG or CNNs in general. So the next step in our group was kind of think of, well, we've done what we could with the hardware. Can we think about how we can make the algorithms themselves more energy efficient? We haven't really changed the algorithms of the CNN yet. And that's a little bit of a challenge when you take a step back. If I give you a CNN or a DNN model, it's very easy maybe to determine the accuracy you measure on the data set. Very roughly speaking, you can say that the number of MACs of that network dictate the speed. A lot of work's been done in this place. You look at the number of weights, and that'll tell you what your memory footprint is. But really, it's not clear how I can take a CNN or DNN model and determine how much energy it consumes. So to address this, the first thing we did was we built an energy evaluation tool. So basically what it does, it takes in the CNN shape, so the different filter shapes, so the height and width of the filters, number of channels, number of filters. It also takes in the weights and the input data, so this can really allow you to capture the sparsity, like where the zeros are in the data. And it factors this all into account. It really looks at basically if you, after you run an optimization here, how much energy you're consuming at each level of the memory hierarchy, as well as the computation energy. And then it basically spits out a breakdown of the energy in terms of how much energy you're consuming per layer and where is the energy actually going. So this would tell you more than, let's say, just measuring it on a system that has, that's a little bit less informative. And right now we're using this model is based on the Iris framework, although we're looking to extend it to other frameworks. And so what do we determine based on this? So something very interesting. If you look at, for example, AlexNet versus SqueezeNet. SqueezeNet is a very nice network that was developed at Berkeley in collaboration with Stanford, and the real focus there was to reduce the number of weights. So they really want to reduce the number of footprint of the network. So we're getting over a 50x reduction in number of weights for the same accuracy as AlexNet. So it's very impressive in terms of doing that. However, if you look at the energy consumption, the energy is actually higher for SqueezeNet compared to AlexNet, and that's quite unexpected. And so if you try and figure out why, the reason why is that really the weights only consume about 20% of the overall energy. You have to also factor in the movement of the feature map data. There's a lot of activation data that's going on, and what's happening with SqueezeNet is that they make it a deeper layer, so the feature map becomes larger and there's more feature map data movement. So really, again, I want to emphasize the number of weights alone is not a good metric for energy. You really should be factoring all different data types. And in fact, you should also be factoring out how the data moves through the memory hierarchy. Another kind of sanity check, there was other publications that also highlighted this. So Movidius back in 2016 at Hopchips also measured these results. So they looked at power efficiency in terms of GOPS per watt. So here, the higher, the better. And they saw that, for a given operation in AlexNet is going to be much more efficient than an operation in SqueezeNet. And again, this has to do with the amount of data movement that has to happen. Right? So this is just something to really factor in that you shouldn't just look at the number of weights or number of MACs and say, hey, this dictates how energy efficient this CNN is. Those are not sufficient metrics for that kind of claim. So taking a step back again, if we look at the accuracy and energy consumption of various different CNN. So for this particular chart, higher and to the left is better. We can see that again. So as we saw, SqueezeNet consumes more energy than AlexNet, but also GoogleNet, even though it has fewer weights, also consumes more energy than AlexNet. So again, I'm just trying to reinforce that, one might have assumed before that, deeper CNNs with fewer weights are more energy efficient, but that is in fact not true, right? Yeah.
In your model, how did you factor for the movement of the data? I mean, measuring that in the model.
Yeah, so the model is based on Iris. So you can have, we basically look at, how much, what is the memory hierarchy and how much you would move through that memory hierarchy in terms of.
Consider the white energy that.
Yes. Yeah. It's the same model that we used to do the data flow analysis before. So it factors all the access energy, the transport energy, and so on. Okay. And so one thing that I wanted to mention is that, so there have been approaches that really look at kind of reducing the network itself by this approach called pruning. And the idea is basically you want to remove the weights that are the smallest. And it shows that it's pretty effective in terms of, you can see the accuracy is about the same, but the energy is reduced. However, one thing you should think through is that does the magnitude of the weight have anything to do with its energy consumption? Right? And it doesn't. So in fact, what you want to do is you actually want to remove the weights that consume the most energy rather than the ways that are smaller. So what we do is we try to bring in this energy. This is one particular approach, but I would say that there's other approaches you can think of where you take in the energy and you basically drive your pruning algorithm by knowing where the energy is actually going. So in particular in this work, what we do is we sort the layers in terms of their energy consumption, and then you prune the layers that have the highest energy first. And the reason for that is as you keep on pruning, it's going to become more and more difficult to prune while still maintaining your accuracy. So you want to basically want to allocate and make the most changes in the layers that consume the most energy. And as a result, you're getting a 3.7x reduction in energy for AlexNet, and even for GoogleNet, you get 1.6x reduction. When you compare it to previous approaches, it's about 1.74x better. Okay? So really, this is one way of doing it, but I really want to encourage you guys to think through, you know, what are the right metrics, especially when I care about energy, and how can I design my algorithms around those as opposed to just weights or number of max. So there's a huge amount of work in this space. So over the past 2 years, we spent a lot of time putting together tutorial and survey material on this. So if you're interested in this space, I would encourage you to either look at the slides that we have on the IRIS website or take a look at this very long proceedings paper that we put together to try and just help really organize all the different types of work that has been going on in this space because there's a huge amount of stuff. Okay, so that's basically it for the CNN side of things. So now I'm just going to talk very briefly about various other projects within our group that are, you know, in certain flavors related to the CNN work. So the first thing is what we call super resolution on a mobile device. So you might be familiar with the task of super resolution. The idea here, there's two different benefits. One is that, you know, let's say I have very bandwidth limited. What you want to do is you want to send a low res version of the video across your network. And then on your actual phone itself, you want to do high-res playback. So can I estimate what a high-resolution image is from this low-resolution image? Another place where this also comes into play is that I'm sure you guys have all seen these 4K TVs, and now there's like 8K TVs. But, you know, video content doesn't evolve that quickly. It's still, most movies are still HD. So how can you generate ultra HD version of the video if your video itself is only HD? And so really, while we want to be able to achieve this, of course, you can do a very simple upsampling to do this, but, you know, bicubic interpolation, it would be really fuzzy. So there's been a lot of research. This is like a whole different area of research that's really focusing on how can we, you know, they call it like hallucinate a very high quality super resolution image from a low res. And as you might not be surprised, the state of the art approaches basically use CNNs, right? So CNNs really kind of taken over a lot of the stuff in computer vision. And so again, you put in a low-res image, and then the output of your CNN is a high-res image. Now, all of the previous work I just talked about in terms of looking at CNNs, we were looking at inputs of, you know, 224 by 224 pixels. Think about how expensive this would be if you're going to do an HD input to generate an ultra HD output. It's going to be very computationally intensive. You can't have that on your phone. Even you don't even want to strap a very expensive, you know, GPU to your TV. So this is, despite all the stuff that we're doing, is this CNN still going to be very expensive? So the question that we asked in our group was, can we think about how the CNN works in an overall system and think of ways to still speed this up, not just at the CNN itself, but on the all the processing around it? So we came up with what we call FAST, which is a framework to accelerate super resolution. The idea is that you take in a compressed video, which is typically what you would have, a super resolution algorithm, and then you would be able to output higher speed super resolution than you could before. And I'll just give some intuition in terms of how this works. So typically, if you talk to computer vision people or image processing people, when I give them a video, they look at it as a bunch of pixels. And that's to be fair. If you talk to someone who worked in the video coding space, they spend a lot of time basically looking at the video and finding a very compressed representation of it. So they don't see the video as a bunch of pixels. In fact, what you send in your compressed video is information about the blocks, about the structure of the video. You talk about the block structure or how different pixels in the video are related. You would send a motion vector to say, oh, you know, this block of pixels here is the same as this block of pixels here. And that's what you're actually sending in your compressed video. So the question that we had is that given that a compressed video is actually a bunch of information about the structure of the video, can we use this to help speed up the task of super resolution? So the answer, again, this is a very quick snapshot, is yes, indeed you can. So rather than using a low-res video and then applying super resolution to each frame to generate a high-res video, what you can do is use a low-res video, apply super resolution to a subset of the frame, so let's say one frame in this example, and then use that structured information that comes for free in the compressed video to tell you basically how to transfer that information and reconstruct all the other videos based on that one high resolution super res video that you generated. Right? So for example, an emotion vector will tell you, oh, just copy these pixels over here in the next frame, and then you don't have to run super res on it again. And so basically this allows you to run super res on a subset of frames, but then you have the benefit of super resolution across your entire video sequence. And so basically how much throughput or improvement that you get from this basically is determined by how many frames of transfer that you actually do. Now I've kind of very much simplified it here. There's actually a lot of challenges related to this because you'll have things like occlusion where someone's blocking in the previous frame. How do you recover that? Sometimes you have these blocky effects that happen in video coding. So if you read the paper, you can learn more about that. But in essence, this is kind of the high level message, which is that you really want to kind of rethink the format of the data that you're getting into a system and how you can exploit that to help you with a given task. In terms of the quality of this, you know, obviously it has to look good, otherwise why would we do this? If you're doing 4x acceleration, if you look at the PSNR, and we tested this across the 20 video sequences that was used in the development of the HEVC standard, you basically get no loss with 4x, as compared to if you just do a bicubic interpolation, we'd get significant PSNR drop. If you do 16x acceleration, you can imagine eventually there's going to be some loss in quality, so you do have a drop of about 0.2 dB, but it's still much better than bicubic interpolation. PSNR doesn't tell you very much sometimes, so it's good to look at the visual quality. So let's say this is ground truth, and this is the super resolution algorithm with CNNs. If I used fast around it, you can see that the quality doesn't change too much, so you can look at kind of the text, whereas, you know, so you can see bicubic is very fuzzy. And so we'd say basically that the complexity of SRCNN with fast is the same complexity as bicubic, but the quality is similar to SRCNN. Another way to look at it is just in terms of the video itself, and again, here's the you know, the highest quality SRCNN for super resolution. Here's the fast with SRCNN, so there's not much discernible difference between these two. And then with bicubic, you can see the quality is significantly more blurry at the text part. Okay, so the main message of here is that, again, you can use transfer that's guided by motion vectors and some other stuff to really, you know, speed up, accelerate this process of super resolution. So even though CNNs themselves, we can make it efficient. You can't make it as efficient as you'd like to, so you can do these type of things. You have to do some adaptive processing, as I mentioned, to adapt for some kind of edge cases where it fails. And overall, you get a 15x speed up. If this is something you're interested in, we also just like release the code on the website. And we're happy to have people take it and do whatever they want with this. Okay, so that's still SRCNN. Some other things that we start to look at in our group was, it's one thing if I just give you an image and then you just classify it. But actually, you know, true test of in terms of do you actually believe what you have in the image is that can you take some action based on it, right? So we start to look at the task of real-time drone navigation, in particular these nano drones, which are, you know, bottle cap size, which have really strict energy restrictions because they can't really carry a very heavy battery. But as a result, that also limits the amount of processing that you can do on chip. So this is in collaboration with Sirtesh Kerman, who's in the Aero-Astro department at MIT. And we've been looking together in terms of, can we build very small systems that can navigate, that are very energy efficient? So you can imagine in a search and rescue situation where you can't rely on, you know, streaming your data to Wi-Fi and waiting for that to tell you what to do. Can you do, you know, navigation so you can, you know, basically last longer, see more, you know, move through the crevices and do it in a very energy efficient way? So one of the first tasks to achieve this is look at the task of what we call visual inertial odometry. The idea there is that I look at visual data around me, and based on the visual data around me, I can try and figure out what the trajectory of the drone actually is. So it takes in, you know, camera information to do this. So you can imagine from one frame to the other, you can guess based on the changes in the frame how you've actually moved. And it also takes in inertial information, so a gyro and accelerometer measurements, and basically you have to do some optimization to bring it together. But fundamentally, the output of this particular task is that you get a trajectory in terms of where you've gone, and also kind of a sparse 3D map of your environment. And so we've, you know, recently taped out this chip, and it's, you know, under review right now for a conference, but it, you know, consumes about 30 milliwatts of power to do all of this type of task. Okay. Fast. And then just to give you guys in terms of a feel in terms of what it actually does, so this is just some simulation with the video. This would be the input to the chip, you know, this kind of 2D visual data. These are all the features that it's detecting, and then the goal of the chip is basically to figure out where it's actually going. So as you can see, as this drone flies through this arena, this is a well-known data set called UROC. This is what the chip is trying to estimate. So the green is the ground truth, and then the blue is what the chip is actually doing, and trying to figure out where you are in this 3D space based on, you know, the visual environment that you see. And that's basically what localization does. Okay, so then one last thing. So it's one thing to sense with, you know, RGB, 2D images, but it's another thing if you actually kind of care about the depth information, right? So there, you've seen a lot of increased use of depth ever since the Kinect type of work. The challenge with getting depth information is that it's basically what we call active sensing. So I have to emit a pulse and then wait for it to come back, and then based on when it comes back, then I know how far an object is. And that typically consumes a lot of power. So the question that we had in my group was, rather than relying purely on this depth sensing, can we offload some of that energy that you would put in depth sensing into the processing itself? Right, because we know how to do processing very efficiently, and we actually like to have very complicated processing because then we can explore that space. So the question here was, you know, let's say I have, I estimate the depth at times T0, and I actually also typically use simultaneously collect an RGB image. Can I then, based on future RGB images, try and estimate what the depth map would be? And I don't have to turn on my depth sensor for the entire time. So my depth sensor is basically duty cycle that's operating at a lower frame rate than my regular image sensor. And so can we develop algorithms to kind of interpolate or guess what the depth is? It's basically exploiting what we would call temporal correlation, so the relationship across time, as well as the relationship between 2D and 3D. And so I'm saying this, of course, is yes, we were able to do an algorithm to this, but the really important thing is to make sure that the algorithm itself is not too complicated, right? If your algorithm's like burning a lot of power, then it negates the impact. So what we did was we implemented the algorithm itself on an embedded processor. In particular, this was an Odroid board. It can do VGA at 30 frames per second on the Cortex A7 processor on that Odroid board. It's a Samsung Exynos processor. So it's consuming less than a watt of active power, or less than half a watt. And just to give you guys in terms of quality of the field, in terms of how it looks like, so let's say this is ground truth of frame 2. This would be the estimated frame 2 and frame 5. So frame 5 typically is going to have more error than frame 2 because you're going to get further and further away. But generally speaking, the mean relative error is under 1%. And if you're assuming that your depth sensor is about 5 watts, you're reducing the system power by 3x. So that's basically it. So at a very high level, again, in terms of summary, there's various energy-efficient approaches that we covered today. So first is really, again, when you're talking about visual data, you want to really minimize data movement. Data movement is very expensive. It's not the operations. How do you get the data to the operations? And particularly when we talk about visual data, there's a lot of data itself. You also have to balance flexibility and energy efficiency. That's also really important. I think, if you work in the hardware space, you know that you can hardwire things and make it very efficient, but there are some applications, for example, in deep learning, where you need to have that flexibility, right? So it's important to figure out that balance. And also in the data itself, you know you can exploit both sparsity and correlation through joint algorithm and architecture design to really minimize the energy consumption. Again, when you're talking about various energy metrics, I think it's really important for you to think of ways to directly target energy itself and not just a proxy metric like weights or max. So that might not be indicative of terms of what your goal is. And still, we have this big fundamental challenge that if you want a linear increase in accuracy, right now it's still an exponential increase in energy. So really, this is something we should all work together and try and solve and address this. At least get it to sub-exponential, almost linear, that would be ideal. Again, if you're interested in all the DNN stuff, we have it all listed on our IRIS website. And then finally, but most importantly, I should also acknowledge all the contributors to this. So this work is not all done by myself, but by many of my students, obviously, as well as our collaborators, and then our various funding sources that pay the bills. So that's it. Thank you.